نستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطيع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. This is the خطبة الحاجة. The khutbah that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم would begin with as an exhortation, as a reminder for the people, for the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم. That reminder that what is to come is serious, so be attentive and pay attention. So we decided, inshallah, if it is all right with those in the masjid, to go through Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qirwani, the Muqaddimah al-Qirwaniya of Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qirwani, and the explanation of Sheikh Ahmad al-Najmi rahimahullah. Alhamdulillah, we were able to go through this book with the explanation of Sheikh Abdul Masih Abbad, hafidhahullah, maybe 2 years ago in Cranford, Masjid Sunnah, and so the tapes are available. But we did it actually mukhtasar, if you like, shortened version, 8 sittings. So this is the explanation using Sheikh Ahmad al-Najmi, and you can benefit from different explanations. And so it is not something which is aib to go through different explanations of the same book, because each alim will bring you different fawaid, each alim will bring you different benefits. And this particular book, alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah, we were able to study it with Sheikh Ubaid ibn Abdullah al-Jabri hafidhullah in 6 lessons. The Sheikh taught it, and likewise Sheikh Abdul Razzaq ibn Abdul Masih Abbad, likewise alhamdulillah, taught it in one of the dawrat, and we benefited from that. So if there are any benefits that we can bring from that, and likewise from Sheikh Muhammad al-Aqil, who also taught it, and inshallah, we are in the process of translating the text as well as bringing some of the fawaid from these scholars, and inshallah this will also aid me in going through another explanation to add more benefit from the a'imma that are alive today and those have just left us. So who is Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qirwani? There is a very nice explanation of his biography that Sheikh Abdul Muhsin brings, Sheikh Abdul Muhsin Abbad brings in the explanation of this muqaddimah, of this introduction. And from what I remember from there is that he quotes as Imam Ahmad, Sheikh Ahmad al-Najmi rahimahullah quotes from al-Dhahabi here, هو الإمام العلامة الفقيه القدوة عالم أهل المغرب أبو محمد عبد الله بن أبي زيد عبد الرحمن النفزي القيرواني المالكي. قيروان, now قيروان, there's a city or an area called Qirwan in Tunisia. Now, Tunisia, in that area, there was no such thing as Tunisia in those days. We're talking about 1,000 years ago. There was no such thing as Tunisia and Morocco. Now, all of that was considered to be Maghrib, the western region, if you like. All of that was considered to be Maghrib. But nowadays, Qirwan is, you can see it on the map, which is in Tunisia. So who is he? He is Al-Allamatul Faqih. Allama. Allama. In Arabic, Allama means like a sign. You can't miss it. Like the ulama, the kibar ulama, like a sign. You can't miss them. As for somebody majhul, you can miss them. Alayhi kadhalik. Somebody unknown, somebody ignorant, unknown. He's majhul, ibn majhul. You can easily miss them. But Allama, you can't miss them. Because they are from the a'imma, from the scholars, from the well-known ulama. And he is not only a Allama, he is a faqih. A person who's well learned and has understanding. So it's not all about hifz. It's not all about memorization. The Khawarij used to memorize. The Khawarij, they used to memorize. They used to pray all night. They used to fast the days. But they didn't have fiqh. And the Messenger ﷺ said, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. Whoever Allah wishes to show goodness to, He gives him understanding of the religion, the fiqh of the religion. And he said to Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, اللهم وفقه في الدين وعلمه التأويل. Oh Allah, give him understanding of the religion and teach him the ta'wil, يعني the tafsir of the Quran. And he became Hibr al-Ummah, that great alim Ibn Abbas, that great mufassir radiallahu anhuma. And so Ibn Abi Zayd, he is a faqih, just like the a'imma, they are fuqaha, and he is a qudwa, an example to be followed. And this is the example of the ulama. They are examples. They don't just give da'wah. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا. He didn't say da'wah يَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. He said وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا. Because many people, they give da'wah, but they are not, they don't have عَمَلَ الصَّالِح. Or they give da'wah and they are not qudwa. They're not examples to be followed. Gives da'wah, then he goes to the cinema afterwards. Or he gives da'wah and then he goes and listens to music. Or he gives da'wah and then he messes around. This is not from the deen. He's not a qudwa. The qudwa are the ulama. They are the qudwa. They are the ones to be followed as examples. Because Allah raised them. Allah raised them. يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمِ دَرَجَاتِ. He raised them many levels with those amongst the believers who Allah subhanahu has raised. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised the ulama because they testify to kalimat al-tawheed. شهد الله أنه لا إله إلا هو والملائكة وأولو العلم. What did he say afterwards? Huh? قائما بالقسط. هكذا علماء. They are upon قسط. They are upright. They are just. They are قائما بالقسط. Because they are away from shirk. And they go towards tawheed. They call to tawheed. They don't call to themselves. قُلْ هَذِهِ السَّبِيلِ أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. They call to Allah. They don't call to themselves. Like you may find some takfiris or some people different jama'at, jama'at takfir, jama'at al-tabligh, or jama'at ikhwa. They call to themselves. Come follow me. Which one? My one. My sheikh. This is what they call to. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ. Use the plural version, not the singular. So you find the muta'assib, those who are muta'assib to a sheikh or a madhab or a Sufi sheikh. Who do we find? My sheikh. Who should it? My sheikh. Why your sheikh? When the asl is, اتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم ولا تتبعوا من دوني أولياء. That is the asl. Follow that which has been revealed to you from your Lord and do not follow other awliya besides that. Other awliya, يعني, even if they are ulama, because they may err in a matter. If the truth comes to you and an alim says something else, another alim brought this other truth to you, you follow that truth and you leave that statement of the other alim. Why? Because the end result, we are following the haqq, the dalil. قال الله, قال رسول الله, وقال الصحابة. And this is what Ibn al-Qayyim rahimullah said. العلم قال الله, قال رسوله, قال الصحابة ليس بالتمويه. ما العلم نصبك لخلاف سفاهة بين الرسول وبين رأي فلاني أو فقيه. Even if it is a alim and the truth you have, the alim made a mistake or erred in that matter, it is foolishness to compare the statement of a alim with the statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah says it's foolishness. Safahatan, he called it foolishness. You have the statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and you tell me, but my sheikh said, la, bring dalil, bring the adilla. And the adilla that you bring, is it sahih? Is it authentic? And whose understanding did you bring from the sahaba? Because we're not allowed to follow our own understanding. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Surah An-Nisa, verse 115, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقَ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيِّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Whoever contends with the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he follows away, whoever contends with the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam after the guidance has been given to him, huh? This is refutation of takfiris, because they don't give the iqamat al-hujjah. They don't. This is refutation of the takfiris, because they make general takfir. Fulan kafir, fulan kafir, fulan kafir, fulan kafir. Did you establish the hujjah upon the person? No. Then how can you? Allah said in the Quran, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقَ الرَّسُولِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى. Because As Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, if they read his books properly, they would see in Majmu' Fatawa he has two rulings. The general ruling, the one who does shirk is a mushrik. Huh? And the specific ruling, the one who does shirk. Huh? Fulan ibn Fulan, and you know that individual, he does shirk, you advise him. Maybe he's ignorant, he needs advice. So, Fulan ibn Fulan, am I allowed to call him a advise him first. Does he intend? Maybe he didn't intend it. Just like the man who said, yeah, just like the man after he lost his provision and then found it and said, oh Allah, you are my slave and I am your Lord. Did he intend it? أخطأ من شدة الفرح. He made a mistake out of being so happy to find his provisions after losing it. He said, a statement of kufr, he said. But this does not take him out. He didn't mean it. He didn't intend it. So how many takfiris who go around calling Muslim kuffar, without establishing the hujjah upon that individual? Ayn al-fiqh? This is when we say faqih, the one who has understanding, this is what we mean. They have fiqh of the religion. Amma ahlul takfir, amma ahlul jama'at tabligh, ikhwan, where is the fiqh in the religion? Jama'at tabligh call to fada'il al-a'mal. Is this the way of the anbiya? The anbiya? وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاشْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. That is the da'wah of the anbiya. We have sent to every nation a messenger. What is the call? Worship Allah and keep away from the false deities. This is the da'wah of the anbiya. As for calling the people to the masjid and you don't even teach them how to pray, everybody prays how he likes. Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna rahimahullah, he went to advise them. And he started teaching them the hadith of the man who prayed badly. So one of the, this was in Egypt, one of their leaders came to him, he says, no, just tell them how to pray. Just tell them to pray. Don't tell them how to pray. Did Rasulullah ﷺ come to teach us how to pray or just tell us to pray? Did Allah just say, pray, khalas? Or did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to follow the Messenger ﷺ? وَمَا أَتَاكُمَ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ. And whatever the Messenger ﷺ gives you, take it. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. And whatever he warns you against or tells you to keep away from, then keep away from. Desist. Keep away from. So following the sunnah of Rasulullah ﷺ, his example is mentioned in the Quran. And this is from the fiqh in the religion. The Messenger ﷺ said in a hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Pray as you have seen me pray. As if you see me pray. صَلُّوا كَمَا. Not how you want to pray. Pray according to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not according to my sheikh and this sheikh and that sheikh, and then all of it is hadith da'if, mawdu', fabricated. Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Pray as if you, just as I pray, just as you have seen me pray. And in Hajj, he said, khudu anni manasikakum, take from me the Hajj rites. Yani, do it like I did it, not how you want to do it. You see the Muslim ummah nowadays. When you go for Hajj and you see how they are. People, nasallahu alayhi wa sallam, doing all sorts of innovations. When they come to the black stone, what do they do? All you have to do is say, if you can't kiss it, say Bismillah Allahu Akbar, and thereafter Allahu Akbar, and sign to it, ishara ilayha. That's it. If you can't kiss it, what do? They go like this. Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna said, as if you're flying, ishada. What is this? Where are you flying? The sunnah of Rasulullah ﷺ has been lost, ya ikhwan. Illa man rahim Allah, except from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the Salafiyun, Ahlul Athar. You go past there, you should know what to say. You go Safa al Marwa, you should know what to say and know what to do. Some of them, they go 14 times because they think this go there and back is one. So following other than the sunnah, you will end up wasting you waste your energy, because the sunnah, iqtisadun fi sunnah, خير من اجتهاد في بدعة كما قال ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه. Economizing on the sunnah is better than striving your utmost upon bid'ah. And now we have 15 Sha'ban coming. You see people upon bid'ah all night worshipping Allah. Did Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم do that? Did the Sahaba do that? What do they call it? Shababarat? Shababarat? In Urdu I think they call it Shababarat. All night. You waste your energy all night. Naam, there's authentic narration about 15 Sha'ban. Authentic narration, what does it say? The narration says, two people, Allah will not forgive that. Allah will forgive all people except two. One of them is a person of shirk. Allah will not forgive him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغْفِرُ أَنْ شِرْكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah will not forgive that one commits shirk with him, and he forgives anything else besides that. وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَئِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ بَلِ اللَّهَ فَاعْبُدْ وَكُنْ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. وَمَا قَدَرَ اللَّهُ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ وَالْأَرْضُ جَمِيعًا قَبْضَتُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ مَطْوِيَّاتٌ بِيَمِينِهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. So shirk Allah will not forgive. And even the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was mentioning, was told by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, say, it has been revealed to you and those before you, if you were to commit shirk, your deeds become null and void. Surah Zumar. If you were to commit shirk, your deeds become null and void, become batil. Shirk. All this comes from fiqh fi deen. So when we read about the ulama and they revive in books of aqeedah, and it is said of them that they are fuqaha, they are faqih. This means that they have understanding of the most important aspect of this deen, at-tawheed. And not only that, the six pillars of iman, belief in Allah and His angels and His books and the messengers that came, and likewise the last day and the pre-decree of good and bad. They have knowledge in detail of these affairs, because Allah said, وَفَصَّلْنَاهُ تَفْصِيلًا. We have detailed it. It's detailed, the sharia. Somebody talk about takfir and all he brings is he's a kafir. Why? Because Allah said, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ. Is that all you have, Yaqi? Dry? Where did you learn your deen? This all you have? One verse? Two verse? Three verse? What about the statements of the ulama and the a'imma? What about the statement of Imam Bukhari rahimahullah in Sahih al-Bukhari? Bab kufr duna kufr. Don't you know that kufr has levels? How could it be that iman has levels and kufr doesn't have levels? MashaAllah, one kufr ala tool is kafir. Without any understanding, this is not fiqh in the religion, and this is not fadl from Allah. By Allah, this person is deprived from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he has not been given fiqh in the religion. As in Bukhari and Muslim, hadith of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiyallahu anhuma, man yuridillahu bihi khayran yufaqqihu fi ddeen. Whoever Allah wishes to show goodness to, he gives him the understanding of the religion. So we have this great imam, al-allamatul faqih, al-alim al-qudwa, أهل المغرب أبو محمد عبد الله ابن أبي زيد القرواني المالكي السلفي. مولده, where was he, when was he born? He was born in the year 310 Hijriya. So we're not talking about yesterday, we're talking about more than 1,020 years ago. More than 1,100 years ago. And he died in the year 386 Hijriya. So that is 76 years old he lived. نشأ منذ صغره على طلب العلم. While he's young, he's upon طلب العلم. And this is the way of the ulama. They memorize Quran at a young age. And they memorize the ahadith and they study from their teachers. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كونوا ربانيين. Be educators, cultivators. بما كنتم تعلمون الكتابة وبما كنتم تدرسون. With what you used to learn and also teach. This is Rabbani. You don't study something, you don't teach something you haven't studied. You may get it all wrong. So go through that which you have benefited yourself, and then teach your family and teach your neighbors and so on and so forth. كما قال القاضي عياض. نعم, قاضي عياض, he said about him, وحاز رياسة الدنيا والدين. He got the authority in his life, dunya and deen, because he got some positions that he was given, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him that the people respected him and honored him in his time. ورحل إليه من الأقطار. And many people from various parts of the world used to go and seek him, seek يعني to benefit from him. وكثر الآخذون عنه. And many students يعني benefited from him. And he has summarized the madhab of Imam Malik رحمه الله. And likewise, he was known as Malik al-Saghir, the young Malik. And if you know Imam Malik rahimahullah, you will know the path that he is holding. What was Imam Malik rahimahullah upon? From the great statements of Imam Malik rahimahullah, number one, he says, a man wanted to do umrah, he wanted to do ihram from the haram, yani from the masjid, from nearby the masjid, and not from Dhul Hulayfa. So Imam Malik rahimahullah says, "Akhsha alayka al-fitna." I fear a trial upon you. He says, "Wama al-fitna fi amyalin aziduha?" What fitna can there be in miles that I'm going to increase? Yani, I'm going to put the ihram on first, and there's maybe 15 miles to the miqat. What fitna can there be? Fi amyalin aziduha. Look, using his aql, huh? What did Imam Malik rahimahullah say? He says, the fitna that I fear for you is what Allah says in the Quran, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبُهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ أَوْ يُصِيبُهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Let those beware who go against his command, lest a trial, tribulation, a fitna will befall them, or a grievous punishment. This is the fitna. By going against the command of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that you're supposed to put, you make your intention from Dhul Hulayfa. There's no harm in putting on your ihram, as long as you don't make the talbiyah until Dhul Hulayfa, which now they call Abyar Ali, but it's actually Dhul Hulayfa. That is the original name. That is where you put your, that is where you do your talbiyah, your intention. Allahumma labbayka bi umrah. And if you're going to do Hajj, Umrah and Hajj. That's what you say when you are at Dhul Hulayfa. You don't make the intention before that. If you do, you have gone against the Sunnah of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So what fitna? The fitna is that you have opposed the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, lest a grievous punishment befalls you. Many of the Hizb al-Tahrir, more than 18 years ago when we were in this country, they used to go around saying, we don't have to grow our beard, مثلاً. We don't have to do because unless there is a punishment attached to the command. Umar Bakri and his men those days. Unless there is a punishment attached to the command. Subhanallah. There's already a punishment attached in the verse. فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبُهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبُهُمْ عَذَابٌ. There's already a punishment attached. عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. It's not punishment. It's not just عَذَاب. It's أَلِيم. It's grievous punishment if you go against the commandment of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Because whatever the Messenger came with is what Allah came with. That revelation is from Allah. وَمَا يَنْتَقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. He doesn't speak of his own accord. It is revelation that is revealed. The Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam himself said, إِنِّي أُوتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ. I have been given the Quran and that which is similar to it with it. So what is this? If you go against the commandment of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it's like you have gone against the commandment of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. Unless, now we bring usul fiqh, for those who want to go further. For those who want to go further, ulama already explained it. Unless a commandment, is another situation arises where the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam allowed that commandment to be just preferable. I give you one example, a simple example that Sheikh Muhammad Bazmul brings. Hafidhahullah, in his book Bughyat Sat Tawwa, he says, for example, we have been commanded, if you miss Salat al-Fajr, yani the Sunnah of Fajr, we have been commanded by the Messenger to pray after sunrise. Command. Don't pray straight after, according to one narration. But there's another narration where a man prayed right after the fard prayer in the presence of the Messenger, his Sunnah that he missed. And the Messenger never said anything to him. So this is what? Sunnah taqririyah, he allowed it in his presence. So the command, which would have been an obligation, and if you went against that obligation, it becomes a punishment, has been brought down now to mustahab. So if you miss your sunnah al-fajr, it's mustahab for you to pray after sunrise. And that's according to one of the positions of the scholars. Other scholars say, no, don't leave an act of worship, don't delay it. Sari'u, rush to do that act of worship. Anyway, there's a difference of opinion on that. But this is one example of where a command can go down to. Where is there a proof to say that the command of growing the beard has gone down to preference? This istihbab. Fi? Ma fi. Idhan, barakallahu fi. Keep it in your pocket. This is not from our deen. We have qala Allah, qala Rasulullah, qala Sahaba, and we have the ulama who explain the sharia. As for many of the ignorant individuals who talk about Allah's deen, like the one that you had in Acton, and he says that trousers below the ankle, no problem. Because in time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what was meant was the izar, the lower garment. MashaAllah, tabarakallah, bring dalil, ya akhi. Whoever says something in the deen, he has to bring proof. Whereas we have in the Quran, we have in the hadith, sahih, ma asfala ma bika'bain fa finnar. Whatever is below the ankle is in the fire. Does it mention izar? No, it doesn't. And ma in the Arabic language is general, anything. whatever is below the ankle. Barakallahu feekum. So Nasha'a, Imam, this is Malik al-Saghir. Al-Dhahabi rahimahullah, I mentioned about him again. He says, Kana rahimahullah ala tariqati salaf. He was upon the path of the Salaf al-Salih, the pious predecessors. And this is the way of salvation, to be Salafi. Don't be shy. Some people are shy. Why call yourself Salafi? Don't call yourself Salafi. We are Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah. Everybody is saying Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah. Even the Asha'ira, the Takfiriyun. In fact, subhanallah, many of the Brelvis now, the Brelvis, even the Brelvis, people shirk, they say, Ya Allah, Ya Muhammad, they say, I'm Ahlul Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. Ahlul Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. So, is it a problem that the ulama said that to ascribe to this blessed path and these blessed people, when they unite, it is deen? Is it a problem? No. The verse we mentioned to you, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقَ الرَّسُولِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيْنَ وَيَتَّبِ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّ وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. This verse, Imam al-Shafi'i rahimullah says, this is proof for ijma' of ijma' being proof. Ijma' of sahaba. Sheikh sometime explained it in his Aqeedah al-Wasitiyah right at the end. He said, ijma' of the salaf, this is what is binding. Because it was easy to ascertain ijma' then. Afterwards, it became more difficult because ulama spread and to different parts. But it was easy to ascertain ijma' then, ijma' of the Sahaba. What's the highest form of ijma'? It's already mentioned by Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You bring it from your head. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam already clarified it. He says, عليكم بسنتي وسنت الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين من بعدي عضوا عليها بالنواجد. He already mentioned ijma' in this hadith of Irbad ibn Sariyah, which is in Musnad Imam Ahmad, and Sunan Ibn Majah, and Sunan Abi Dawood, and in other Sunans. Hadith which is narrated by many, but you cannot even say it is da'if, as some of those ignorant individuals try to claim. This hadith is sahih. Sahih li kathrat al-shawahid. Alaykum bi sunnati wa sunnat al-khulafa al-rashidin. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, their path, what they united upon is deen. Is deen. As mentioned by Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah in this verse. And also of a'imma, past and present. Many a'imma. You can't even, yani, Sheikh Sam, how many times he mentions ijma' in his Majmu' Fatawa? How many times he clarified it as well in Majmu' Fatawa? And other than him from the a'imma, mentioning ijma' after ijma' after, subhanallah. And then somebody comes now, wants to whisper in your ear, saying to you that only Quran and Sunnah we don't follow. Because why? He will be exposed. He will be exposed if you don't have Faham al-Sahaba. He will be exposed if you don't have Faham al-Salaf. Khawarij, they thought they were following Quran and Sunnah. Khawarij. When Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma came to them, they thought they were following Quran and Sunnah. What was the first thing? One of them, one of the foolish ones amongst them, what did he say? He saw a cloak that Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma was wearing. He said, oh, look what he's wearing. Isn't this what the Khawarij of today are like? They try to make fun of the ulama. They try to mock the ulama. He said, look what he's wearing. You know what Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu refuted him with? He said, the Messenger said, were better than this. Allahu Akbar. Hakadha faham al-salaf, faham al-sahaba radiallahu anhum. And khalas, he's quieted now. Who's next? Out of 6,000, 4,000 turn back. Allahu Akbar. This is fiqh that the Messenger sallallahu made dua for him. And even though the other Sahaba were afraid for him to go out and debate with them, but he went out. Look how brave Ibn Abbas, and he defeated them. What did they have? They had verses. In al-hukmu ila lillah. Ruling belongs to Allah, which they didn't even apply to themselves in their aqidah and their manhaj. Many of the takfiriyun and the jama'at al-haditha, al-muhdatha, the newly invented groups, because that's what they are, Sheikh Ubayd Hafidhah says, they are newly invented. They don't apply this verse to themselves. That ruling belongs to Allah. Because if they did, they wouldn't be misguided. If they did, they wouldn't follow. They wouldn't deviate from the Quran and Sunnah and the understanding of the Salaf. But understand Salaf, when you say Salafi, they try to take you away from that. Why? Because this is the understanding which will keep you upon salvation. In Aqidah and in your manhaj. Who said that? Allah Azza wa Jalla said it. In Surah Al-Baqarah, وَإِنْ آمَنُوا بِمِثْلِ مَا آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ فَقَدْ اِهْتَدَوْا. And if they believe as you believe, you Sahaba believe? Surah Al-Baqarah, just after about 132, verse 130 of 132. وَإِنْ آمَنُوا if you believe as they believe, they will be guided. The Sahaba رضي عنهم. When they united, it was deen. And the highest from Ijma' we mentioned, the Khulafa al-Rashideen. The Prophet himself said, follow the example of those two after me. Who? Abu Bakr and Umar, Siddiq رضي عنهم. So, did they oppose the Sunnah? No, they did not. When they came together, they did not oppose the Sunnah. So his Aqeedah, this Ibn Abi Zayd, he was upon the way of the Salaf. And there's no harm in saying I'm Salafi. Rather, this is a distinction between you and falsehood, and you and the other misguided groups. Who said? Shaykh Sam Taymi Rahmullah, volume 4, page 149. Majmu' Fatawa, La Aiba. La Aiba. Liman Adhara Manhaj al-Salaf, or Madhab al-Salaf. There's no harm. The one who apparently professes the Manhaj of the Salaf. Wa'tazza ilayh. And he ascribes to it. How do you ascribe? Salafi. This is how you ascribe. You say, nowadays people have no problem to say I'm Jazairi or Maghrabi or Britani or Amriki. MashaAllah, they ascribe to the country, they have no problem. And you have a problem ascribing to the best people. Khayrun nasi qarni thumma ladina yulunahum thumma ladina yulunahum. Hadith Sahih Bukhari, Mutawatir. You have a problem with that? Ascribing to the best people. How could it be? And also, we have many cases. Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah himself, in his Sir Alamu Nubala, how many times he mentions Fulan Salafi, Fulan Salafi, Fulan Salafi? How many times? When he said Abdullah Mubarak al-Salafi, rahimahullah. Abdullah Mubarak al-Salafi. When did Abdullah Mubarak die? 110 Hijriya. Very close to the source. And he called him al-Salafi. Abdullah Mubarak al-Salafi. So therefore, and the A'imma of today. And I asked Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen Rahimullah myself, the only thing that Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen Rahimullah was against is that person use it as like hizbiyah, partisanship, that he feels that he's safe, khalas, he's in Jannah. But we don't say it like that. We say, I'm Salafi, and this humbles us, Allah. This humbles us that this is the path, and they are our qudwa, our example. We don't say it to be proud and arrogant. This is not the manhaj of the Salaf. This is not the manhaj of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Sahaba رضي الله عنهم were not arrogant and proud, and didn't feel self-sufficient. Rather, even though they knew they were promised paradise, they still were humble, and they humbled themselves. So Malik al-Saghir al-Salafi fi usul la yadri al-kalam, la yadri al-kalam. He doesn't know kalam. Kalam like philosophy, rhetoric. People say, "I think my opinion is not upon that." Philosophers. ولا يتأول, doesn't bring his own understanding of affairs. فنسأل الله التوفيق. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for التوفيق. And he benefited from many of the scholars, from them Muhammad ibn Surur al-Hajjam, Muhammad ibn Fath, al-Hasan ibn Nasr al-Basusi, and other than them from the scholars who came before him. And he mentions here some of the students. Now let's go straight into the first section so that we can save time, inshallah. قال أبو محمد عبد الله ابن أبي زيد القرواني رحمه الله تعالى الحمد لله الذي ابتدأ الإنسان بنعمته وصوره في الأرحام وبحكمته. This is actually the first part of it. But what I want to go to is actually the aqidah of the Imam. That way, beginning from that section there. Because of time, we have maybe 6 weeks before Ramadan, inshallah. No. قال أبو محمد عبد الله بن زيد ابن أبي زيد القرواني رحمه الله باب ما تنطق به الألسنة وتعتقده الأفئدة من واجب أمور الديانات. This is the chapter heading. The chapter heading, يعني what the tongues utter and what the afida, which is the plural of fuad, the hearts, what they believe in, from the obligatory matters of this deen. This is the first part of the book. And at the end he mentions amal al-salih, also from iman, just so that nobody slanders this great imam and says that he only says iman is qawlun bil-lisan wa i'tiqadun bil-janan. No, he also says at the end that amal al-jawarih as well, in three. Iman is in statement of the tongue, actions of the limbs, and belief in the heart. The heart, there's two things of the heart. There is the statement of the heart and the action of the heart. The statement of the heart is your aqeedah. And the action of the heart is your, the actions like your love, your hate, your hope, your tawakkul, your reliance, and other than that. That is from the actions of the heart. And the statement of the heart is your aqeedah. All of that is iman. من ذلك الإيمان بالقلب. From that is to have belief in the heart, the Imam says. والنطق باللسان and statement of the tongue. أن لا إله إلا الله. أن الله إله واحد. That Allah is one deity who deserves to be worshipped. لا إله غيره. There is no other deity who deserves to be worshipped other than him. ولا شبيه له. Who has no similitude. يعني no one that can be likened unto Allah. ولا نظير له. Again, similar. No one similar to him as an example. Cannot be given an example to Allah. No one can be used as an example to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or alongside Allah, you cannot. ولا ولد له. And no child to him. He begets not. ولا والد له. Nor does he have parents. ولا صاحبة له. Nor does he have a companion. ولا شريك له. Nor does Allah have a partner. ليس لأولويته ابتداء. His beginning, his being the first, doesn't mean that he has a beginning. Allah being the first, it doesn't mean that he has a beginning. He's the first and he's the last. He's the first, as the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, he's the first, no one before Allah. And he's the last, there's no one after Allah. And that is in Surah Al-Hadid. هو الأول والآخر والظاهر والباطن. نعم. ولا لآخريته انقضاء. Nor is it to be said that his being the last has an end. يعني, nor is it to be said that Allah being the last means that he has an end. We don't say that. He is the first, no one before him. And he is the last, no one after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا يَبْلُغُ كُنْهَا صِفَتِهِ الْوَاصِفُونَ. And no one from those who try to explain how he is will be able to know how he is. As to know who he is according to what he told us, نعم. Allah told us he's above the arsh. We believe that. How? We don't ask. As Imam Malik rahimahullah said, وَالْكَيْفُ مَجْهُولٌ. And كيف is unknown. وَالْإِمَانُ بِهِ وَاجِبٌ. And to believe in that is obligatory. وَالسُؤَالُ عَنْهُ بِدْعَةٌ. And to question it is innovation. So كيف is مجهول, is unknown. How? His attributes are unknown. Unknown to us. Sheikh Ubayd Hafidhullah says, adds to that and he says, but they are known to Allah. The كيف is known to Allah, but is unknown to us. Because Allah did not tell us about the kayfiyyah. He told us about his beautiful names and lofty attributes, and that's it. We believe in that which Allah and his Rasul described Allah with, and stop there. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is no one comparable unto him. وَهُوَ سَمِيعٌ بَصِيرٌ. And he is all hearing, all seeing. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. And there is no one comparable unto him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. Allah, to him belongs the most honorable of examples, the best of examples. You can't speak bad about Allah and liken him to his creation. No. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Surah Maryam, verse 65, رَبُّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And this is proof of the three categories of Tawheed. Those who add a fourth, barakallahu fik. Keep it in your pocket, because this is in the Quran. مُسْتَقْرَأَ, as Sheikh Saif Uzan says, derived directly from the Quran. Three categories of Tawheed, not four. Where is it? In the middle of the Quran, Allah says, Surah Maryam, verse 65, رب السماوات والأرض وما بينهما. Your Lord of the heavens and the earth and that which is between them. He's the Lord of everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَاعْبُدْهُ. So the first one was Lordship, Rububiyah. فَاعْبُدْهُ وَاصْطَبِرْ لِعِبَادَتِهِ. So worship him and be patient upon his worship. هَلْ تَعْلَمُ لَهُ سَمِيَّةِ. Do you know any similitude unto Allah? Again, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There's no similitude unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Three categories of Tawheed. Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, when we visited him in Unayza over 10 years ago, he mentioned this verse to me. And he said, and I saw it afterwards in his books. Rabbu Samaw, and he said there's three categories of Tawheed. As for those who say Hakimiyya is the fourth, who said? From the Imma of the past. Always catch them with this. Who said? Because the Imma of the past, they all mention three categories. Even those that mention two, actually it's three. If you look at, they put two in one. And that is Tawheed al-Ma'rifah wal-Ithbat, Ma'rifah of Allah, and to affirm that He is the Lord. Tawheed al-Ma'rifah wal-Ithbat, and Tawheed al-Qasd wal-Talab. Qasd is what, who you seek in your worship. Uluhiyya. The first one is Rububiyya and Asma'u Sifat, and this one is Uluhiyya. So what's the problem? And the Imam of the past, Ibn Battah and other than them, they mentioned three categories of Tawheed. Imam al-Tahawi rahimahullah, three categories. What do they want then? If the Imam passed right until present. And three categories of Tawheed is in Fatiha. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Rububiyya, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Asma'u Sifat, Maliki Yawm al-Din, he's the owner of the Day of Judgment. This is Rububiyya and Asma'u Sifat. Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'in. Uluhiyya, worship. Three categories of Tawheed at the end of the Quran. Qul A'udu bi Rabbin Nas, Rububiyya, Maliki Nas, huh? Maliki Nas, huh? Asma'u Sifat, he's the Malik, huh? He's the king. Because Rububiyya, we mentioned the first one, but you can also say Rububiyya as well, because it comes under that. Because from the meanings of Rububiyya, as Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah says, is that he's the Malik, the Mudabbir, huh? He's the Malik and he's the Mudabbir, and he's the Khaliq. Three meanings of Rububiyya, Aqid al-Wasitiyya of Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah. Three meanings of Rububiyya. But anyway, the last one is Ilahin Nas. This is Uluhiyya, Ibadah. And the Quran is all like that. Imam al-Maqrizi from the 9th century, Shafi'i Imam, rahimahullah, he mentions also some additional fawaid. He says there are some surahs specifically to do in one particular aspect of these three categories. So for example, he mentions about Surah Al-Ikhlas, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ لَمْ يَلِدْ. All of this is Asma'u Sifat. And قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. All of it is what? لا أعبد ما تعبدون ولا أنتم. All of it is ألوهية, عبادة. And قل أعوذ برب الفلق. All of it is من شر ما خلق من شر. All of it is ربوبية. That He is the Creator, He is the Lord, and so on. So they mentioned it. He mentioned it as categories like that. نعم. ولا شريك له. And He has no partners. ليس لأوليته ابتداء ولا لآخرته انقضاء ولا يبلغ كنها صفته الواصفون ولا يحيط بأمره المتفكرون. Those who want to try to think as to how Allah's beautiful names and attributes are, they will not be able to encompass and know it fully. How? We don't know how. ولا يتفكرون في ماهية ذاته. أهل السنة, they don't look and try to find out about the how of His essence is. We don't. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the arsh, and His beautiful names and attributes, and He has mentioned those to us, and those names are not limited to 99. There are other names that He has kept with Himself that He hasn't told us about, and we don't know how, but we believe in them. We affirm them for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the best of ways. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءٍ. Nor will they be able to encompass any of His knowledge except that He wills. وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلَا نَعَمْ وَلَا يُؤُدُوا حِفْظُهُمَا وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ. This is from Ayat al-Kursi, Surah al-Baqarah, that His kursi, His footstool, extends over the heavens and the earth, and no fatigue does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have in protecting them and guarding His creation. وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ. And He is Al-Ali, the one who is the All-High, Al-Azim, the one who is the All-Great and the Exalted. So just the first part, if we read it, Sheikh Ahmad al-Najmi rahimahullah, one of the great scholars that was alive this decade and this century. Alhamdulillah, we were able to see him in Samita, which is in the southern part of Saudi Arabia, about 8 years ago. We went to see him, he was sick, and we went inside his maktaba and he was there lying down on his bed. And he said, if you have come to read, then make sure you have tazkiyah. He's sick and he said, you have come to, if you want to read, then you make sure you have a tazkiyah from Sheikh Rabi' or Sheikh Ahmad al-Najmi. Because many people, they try to cheat. They go there, take from him the qira'ah, the reading, and they go and get tazkiyah from him and they go and misguide others. So he wants to make sure that you are salafi and you are with the mashayikh al-salafiyin. So if you benefit, alhamdulillah. And not that you use him for that. To read to him, get tazkiyah, and then go and run with it. Like nowadays, you have some of these shabab. One props up in Acton, one props up here, I have tazkiyat. Tayyib, mashallah, you are a student of such and such sheikh, but was he upon this? No, he wasn't. You are a student of Sheikh Albani, mashallah, tabarakallah, Allah rahamu. But Sheikh Albani, rahmullah, used to cooperate with the innovators? No, he didn't. He refuted them. Sheikh Albani, rahmullah, was not like this. So, to say I'm a student, means that you ascribe to their methodology, and their manhaj, and their aqidah. Now we have this one saying, he's student of Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, or Sheikh ibn Baz, rahimahullah, mashallah. What do? They sign petition, so that Hizb al-Tahrir do not get banned. Subhanallah, Sheikh ibn Baz, rahimahullah, and Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen like this? They agree with Hizb al-Tahrir, this aqlaniyun, these so-called intellectualists. They use aql in front of text. These are the Mu'tazila of today. As Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah, he called them, in refutation of them, called them Afrakh al-Mu'tazila, not even Mu'tazila, he called them. Yeah, he called them Afrakh. You know Afrakh? Chicks of the Mu'tazila. Not even Mu'tazila, because Mu'tazila, they used to have doubts then. Mu'tazila will be ashamed of them. They'll say, well, you're like this? Khawarij today will be ashamed of the Takfiris now. You are like this? like the Khawarij nowadays, they say you can steal, you can go to, you can take the, and they think they're in Dar al-Harb. Go to Waitrose and steal the best pomegranates or whatever. Because they think they're in Dar al-Harb, stealing from the Kuffar. SubhanAllah. The Khawarij then, they didn't used to lie. Even lie they didn't used to do. Nowadays they are stealing, they are lying, they are cheating on the internet. Kadhib. You name it, they are upon it. So they'll be ashamed. That's why Sheikh Rabi' Hafidhullah said, the Khawarij of today are worse than the Khawarij then. How? The Khawarij then were known. They were in their own place. Nowadays they're scattered around. And also, you find them the biggest liars and the biggest cheats. He says, I'm Amir Mu'minin in Slough, he said. Amir Mu'minin. How? Nobody knows you. Only that Stoke Podge's Lane, they know you, that area there. As for the whole of the Ummah knows you. MashaAllah, the whole Ummah is sinful then, therefore. According to that statement there, the whole Ummah is sinful. Because when you go to China, nobody knows you. When you go to Saudi Arabia, nobody knows you. You go to Yemen, nobody knows you. You're majhul. How are you be Amir Mu'mineen, ya akhi? But he had a following of ignorant individuals. Later on, what did they become? They became Sufis. So what? From one deviation to another. But alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah, and it's only from Allah, that the Salafiyun, the people of Al-Athar, this is the blessed path. Those who stick with the ulama, they don't deviate to the right and left. What you saw 20 years ago, 40 years ago, is what you see today. Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah, Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah, Sheikh bin Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, Sheikh Muqbil, rahimahullah, and their students who treaded their path, this is the Sirat al-Mustaqim. وَأَنَّ هَذَا Sirat al-Mustaqim. فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ Other paths. وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَن سَبِيلِهِ It will lead you away from his path. ذَلِكَ وَصَّاكُمْ بِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ That which he has advised you with, that you may gain piety. It's for your own benefit, Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, to be upon this blessed path. It's for your own benefit. Look, yesterday, there were some individuals calling to Quran and Sunnah in the understanding of Salaf. But they left the ulama. Abu al-Ali Yasir Khil Sharif. Now he's got a website called Ibn al-Jawziyah Institute. He's calling to Sufism. Hey, na'am. Calling to Sufism. And you know what he says about Shabbat Barat, 15 Shabbat? He has an article there called What's the Fuss About? SubhanAllah. The fuss is, Ya Abdullah, Ya Faqir ilallah, wa nahnu kulluna fuqara. The fuss is, you have opposed the Sunnah of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Because the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not specify that day or night for ibadah. Yes, he said his blessed day, that Allah, in the sense that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive except two individuals, those who do shirk and the other one, those who have problems, shahna wa baghda, yani enmity between two brothers, Allah will not forgive those on that night. Hadith sahih. Lakinna, we don't have anything from sahaba, ijma' of sahaba. You see, nowadays, mashallah, tabarakallah, many of these deviated individuals, what they want to do is, if you say to them Salaf, they say, oh, I found one. It's not like that, ya akhi. Salaf doesn't mean that you just found somebody from the Salaf, like Abu al-Hasan al-Ma'ribi did. He found somebody to say what you... It's not like that, ya akhi. Maybe somebody made a mistake. And the one who follows the shawadh, who follows the mistakes, huh, of the ulama, what will happen to him? He's going the path of destruction. Everything he wants, mistake, khalas. He made his own manhaj of the mistakes. Why, ya akhi? We have Quran, Sunnah, and Ijma' of the Sahaba. So don't bring one, bring Ijma' that they're united upon this. This is the da'wah of Allah Azza wa Jal. Not somebody made a mistake. No. And especially if you try to highlight the mistakes of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, when they are the best people from this Ummah. Khayrun nas, qarni, thumma ladhina ilunam. So how can you try to give examples of their errors? Just like Al-Ma'ribi did. And people nowadays say, what's the fuss about? You have these two areas as if nothing is gone wrong. The fuss, ya akhi, is aqidah and manhaj. When this individual says that Usama bin Zayd, he also did not have husn al-dhan. He did not have good opinion. Speaking against Usama radiallahu anhu. Or he himself was hasty. Is that good to say about Usama radiallahu anhu? When he killed the mushrik? When he said, after he said, la ilaha in a battlefield, killed him and he's... Prophet said, you killed him. He said, la ilaha illallah. And he felt so bad. Look at the remorse of Usama bin Zayd radiallahu anhu. And you criticize him. You criticize him. Look at the remorse. He said, I wish I only became Muslim that day. And when the fitna occurred after him, he said, he actually never took part in it, fearing that he'll kill another Muslim. This is Usama radiallahu anhu. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'een. All of them. They are promised paradise. Radiallahu anhum wa radu anhu. How can you even highlight an error of theirs and try to highlight it as if they are, yani, as if, subhanallah, yani, you try to bring the, you try to dishonor them. Rather, as the Messenger says, لو أن أحدكم تصدق بأحد ذهبا ما بلغ مد أحد ولا نصيفة. If any one of you were to give charity the size of gold, the size of Uhud, you will not even reach two hands put together, the measure, mud, or even half of that. Sheikh Rabi Habibullah says in his explanation of Usul Sunnah, that is considering they only did that. But what else did they do? How many Uhuds do they have in gold? How many jihads they fought? How many migrations, those who went to Habasha, those who went to Medina? How many torturing they went through to defend this deen? How many ahadith they carried for us? Sheikh Ahmad al-Najmi rahimahullah. After praising Allah, the Lord of the worlds, he says, وَالصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَىٰ أَشْرَفِ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. Salatu wassalam. Salatu Allahi ala al-Rasul, ذِكْرُهُ فِي الْمَلَئِ الْأَعْلَىٰ. As Abu al-Aliya said, Abu al-Aliya from the Salaf, not this one. Abu al-Aliya from the Salaf, he said, ذِكْرُهُ فِي الْمَلَئِ الْأَعْلَىٰ, in Bukhari. It is to make mention of the Messenger وسلم, in the highest of places. So when we say Sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we are actually saying, may Allah make mention of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the highest of places, and his family, and the companions. Wasallam, may Allah protect them. This is what Sallam means. So when you say Salaamu Alaikum, it's not just peace be upon you, as some of the loosely translate. It actually means, may Allah protect you. May Allah's protection be upon you. SubhanAllah. And we all need the protection of Allah. نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين صلى الله عليه وسلم. So Sheikh Ahmad al-Najmi رحمه الله said, the first part, the meaning of that is الإيمان بالقلب أي التصديق. The meaning of إيمان in the heart is التصديق. He says بوحدانية الله, to trust in the oneness of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. مؤكدا ذلك بالنطق, and you affirm that with the utterance of the tongue, and that is the كلمة التوحيد, and أن الله إله واحد لا إله غيره, وهذا معنى لا إله إلا الله. فكلمة لا إله, there is no deity worthy of worship, مركبة من جملتين, جملة النفي وجملة الإثبات, as you all know, and that is negation and affirmation, because لا in Arabic here is لا نافية. لا نافية has to have an ism and a خبر. The ism is what? إلها. لا إلها, negating any form of worship, any deity that is worship. إلا الله is not the خبر. إلا الله is جملة استثنائية, the جملة of exception. So where's the خبر? There has to be a خبر there. The news, the predicate, there has to be a meaning behind it, after it. No deity, what? No deity. The ulama of the Arabic language and fiqh, and those who have fiqh, they say, لا إلها, and the إلها is the ism, and the خبر is معبود بحق. No deity deserves to be worshipped. So deserves to be worshipped is the خبر of لا نافية. So if you know the Arabic language, you know the meaning of La ilaha illallah. Many Muslims don't know the meaning of La ilaha illallah. They say it's, there is no God but God, or there is no God but Allah. That doesn't give you the meaning of why this da'wah of Rasulullah ﷺ went through so much hardship. Because if you just said there's no God but God, the kuffar of the mushrikun of Quraysh, they will have no problem with that. They said, no God but God, you have your God, I have my God, we all have one God. And they all lead to one. The crunch of the matter was when he said, لا معبود بحق إلا الله وعبد الله ما لكم من إله غيره. When he said the second part, that was the crunch, and that was the war that they stood against the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he said there's no other deities worthy of worship except Allah. So لا إله, he mentions here, has a نفي and إثبات, negating anything that doesn't deserve to be worshipped except Allah. And then he says that has to be followed up with the tongue. The tongue with the highest form of dhikr is to say La ilaha illallah. That's the highest form. With the tongue is La ilaha illallah. To testify. None has the right to be worshipped except Allah. And this La ilaha illallah is sacred. Has an honor that Allah has placed. Every Muslim to another Muslim is honorable. As the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إن دماءكم وأموالكم وأعراضكم حرام عليكم كحرمة هذا اليوم كحرمة هذا المكان. Your blood, your property and your honor is sacred for you, just like the sacredness of this day and the sacredness of this place. It was يوم عرفة in the Haram Sharif, the Haram, sacred. So your honor is more sacred than that. Your honor is sacred, is as sacred as that, as the Messenger says, كحرمتي, as sacred as that. So the Muslim is honorable who says La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, is honorable. So how you call him a kafir without just cause, without establishing the proof on him? How you call him a kafir? The Prophet said, Man qala li akhihi ya kafir faqad ba'a bihi ahaduhuma. Whoever says to his brother, O kafir, it falls on one of the two. If it's true, if it's not true, it falls back on you. Call your Muslim brother a kafir. And now they have blanket statement. Why all of the rulers are kuffar? Did you establish the hujjah upon all of them? You can't even name them. You can't even name them. And you're saying all of them? Establish the hujjah. Just like Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said, volume 12, page 200. Establish the hujjah. If you have majmu' fatawa, bring it now and read it. If you have you have to do iqamat al-hujjah before you do hukum al-mu'ayyin, the specific ruling of takfir. You have to establish the hujjah upon the person. It's blanket takfir. So kalimat la ilaha illallah is sacred. That's why the Prophet said to Usama, you killed him, and he said la ilaha illallah. How will you be on yawm al-qiyamah when la ilaha illallah comes defending this man? How will you be? كيف تكون يوم القيامة? La ilaha illallah comes defending him. If يعني he said it truthfully. How? How will you be? La ilaha illallah is sacred. And La ilaha illallah has conditions. From its con- the seven conditions of La ilaha illallah. Does anyone know them? Does anyone know the seven conditions of La ilaha illallah? Seven conditions. We all must be, if we are truly upon La ilaha illallah, we must be upon La ilaha illallah, upon these seven conditions. Hafiz al-Hakami, rahimullah, mentions it in, huh? In Sulam al-Wusul, and the explanation of its ma'arij al-Qabul, in both. Al-Ilmu, huh? Wal-Yaqeenu wal-Qabulu. Knowledge of La ilaha illallah. Yaqeen, having certainty of La ilaha illallah, that this is the haq. Huh? Wal-Qabul, and accepting it. Accepting Allah, the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Huh? العلم واليقين والقبول والانقياد. انقياد, to comply everything that Allah tells you to do. Keep away from what He forbids you from. Comply, compliance. انقياد. والصدق والإخلاص والمحبة. صدق, truthfulness. To be truthful to La ilaha illallah. والإخلاص, sincerity. And محبة, and having love for La ilaha illallah and those upon La ilaha illallah. وفقك الله لما أحبه. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enlighten you to that which He is pleased with. And with that, we summarize inshallah. جزاكم الله خيرا وسبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك.